Who is it? Hey Jim, good to see you again. Sorry, Dr. Velocity, I'll listen. I have this exam coming up soon, and I mean, I just don't get this average versus instantaneous velocity stuff. I mean, you've got to catch me up to speed. This is really going to lower my average at this point in time. Of course, you don't call me Dr. Velocity for nothing.
Okay, so let's get some basics out of the way. Do you know what the difference is between speed and velocity?
Well, Prof, everybody knows that speed is a scalar. It's either positive or it's zero, and it doesn't really say too much. Whereas velocity is a vector. It's positive, negative, or zero, and actually represents a direction. But the thing I don't really get is, what is average velocity? Like, what is and how do you calculate it?
So, average velocity can be defined as a change in displacement over a given time interval. And the way we find average velocity is by drawing a secant on a position versus time graph. So, given a displacement versus time graph for an accelerating object, we can actually find the average velocity for any given time interval. So, assuming time 1 is over here, and time 2 is over here, to find the average velocity by drawing a secant between these two points. Remember that a secant is any line that crosses over a curve at two different points. So the whole point of finding the average velocity is that it gives a pretty good approximation of the velocity of an object through a given time interval.
So why is it important that I know this? Like, where can this be used?
Well, average velocity can be applied in a number of different instances, and one example of which being Usain Bolt.
Although Usain Bolt's velocity changed over the course of the race, most people summarize his performance with an average velocity of 10.4 meters per second.
Usain Bolt, challenged by Tyson Gay. Usain Bolt, two
clear. Okay, Prof, that sounds fair, but what about instantaneous velocity? Like, what's that? Because if you take, like, the position versus time graph, and you keep shortening that time interval, you're just going to get 0 over 0, which is meaningless.
Well, instantaneous rate of change can be defined as the velocity of an object at one particular point in time. And funny enough, the Greeks were actually philosophizing about instantaneous velocity thousands of years ago.
The ancient Greeks put themselves into two streams. Some believe that motion was meaningless, as 0 over 0 is an undefined quantity. Others argue that the concept of zero time itself was flawed, as time would never be able to move on, given that an infinite amount of instants would have to occur for it to do so. This notion is best captured in Zeno's paradox, appropriately named the Fletcher's paradox.
So there are really four ways we can calculate instantaneous velocity, some easier than others, and some requiring special cases. Here's number one. So in this instance, an object is traveling with a uniform velocity. The average velocity over any given time period will be exactly the same as the instantaneous velocity at any given point in time, as you'll see later in case 4. Now, if you were to plot the velocity versus time for this graph, you'll get a straight line moving across. Now, as you can see, no matter if your point, well, your first and second time are here and here, or here and here, or if you're just looking at any time, for example, just there or just here, it's always going to be the same velocity because it's a straight, flat line. Now, case 2 also involves a special condition where you have to know a bit beyond the scope of the question. And in doing so, you can solve for the instantaneous velocity with the kinematics equation. For example, this equation, you can solve for v1 given unknown time and displacement and acceleration. A third way you can solve for the instantaneous velocity is by using calculus methods. And you can either use the first principles approach or find derivative. And in doing that, you could find the instantaneous velocity at a given point in time, although it may require a bit more effort and a bit more knowledge in the mathematics. However, there is one final way to calculate it, which works very well with experimental data. So, case 4 here implies an accelerating object, although it can work for an object with any kind of position to time relationship. So if you were to find the instantaneous velocity at any given time period, all you have to do is draw a tangent to the line or to the curve on a distance versus time graph. In doing so, the slope of this tangent will equal instantaneous velocity at that point in time.
So why does a tangent actually represent the instantaneous velocity?
The slope of a secant can actually approach the slope of a tangent by drawing the points closer and closer to here. So if you were to draw a point here and go through there, you'll find that the slope of the secant is considerably less than the slope of the tangent. However, as you move this point closer and closer to that point, you'll find that the slope of the secant will actually approach the slope of the tangent. So really, tangents is really just kind of a different perspective of secants.
Why would I possibly need to know the instantaneous velocity of an object?
Instantaneous velocity takes center stage in many different scenarios. An example of which being the free fall of Felix Baumgartner. Because if you just use an average velocity equation, you'll never be able to figure out when exactly Felix breaks the sound barrier. But if you use the instantaneous velocity method, you could figure out exactly at what point of time Felix can break the sound barrier.
Okay, but when should I know when to use average velocity versus instantaneous velocity? Like, is there some kind of analogy I could use to help me differentiate the two?
So, as you can see, there are many differences between average and instantaneous velocity and what situations you want to use it in. So, in the case of an accelerating object, any accelerating object, average velocity isn't really too useful unless you're really focused on one particular time period. Most of the time, for an accelerating object, the velocity is always changing. And as such, the instantaneous velocity is really the only thing that can accurately depict what an object is doing at any given time. Another useful analogy that you can use to help comprehend the difference between average and instantaneous velocity is to think about it in terms of a road trip. So if you're going to start at some point A and venture off to some point B, the average velocity would tell you that for that given time interval, you're going to be moving with this velocity. However, based on the pattern of freeways and roads, your actual path will look something like this. You might be going east for a bit, and then north, then east again. So as such, your instantaneous velocity is never really going to equal your average velocity. And based on this diagram, you're much better off using the instantaneous velocity to figure out what is actually happening at any given point in time. So do you have any questions or anything you'd like to add?
Well, Prof, I'd love to stay and chat and all, but unfortunately, it looks like I'm running out of time.